Sorry to interrupt, ma'am, but you have stopped the presenting screen.
Yes, after my introduction, I'll start. Do you want me to share it now only?
No, ma'am, okay.
A very warm and pleasant good morning to all. A world is full of diamonds and gems, and we are having some of them here today. To build this event, with this note, I, Dipali Randive, would like to extend heartiest welcome to our this morning speaker, Dr. Manjushri Sardeshpande ma'am, all the dignitaries, my colleagues, and all my dear friends. All dear students, on behalf of Prerna College of Commerce, on the 7th day of online certificate course in communication skills, I am sure that all the participants will enjoy learning a lot from this session today, and it will be an enriching experience for all of us. I feel very glad and honored to announce that on 7th day of this program, we have a very versatile personality with us, Dr. Manjushri Sardeshpande ma'am. She will deliver a talk on effective non-verbal communication. Now, let me have the privilege to welcome and introduce this remarkable personality and our very special guest for today. She is MA, BEd, LLB and PhD. She is the head of Department of English and IQAC coordinator of R.S. Mulle Dharampet Arts and Commerce College, Nagpur. She has 29 years of rich experience. She is well-known poet, writer, editor, resource person, translator and teacher's trainer. Her poems have been published in newspapers and various anthologies. She is also a PhD supervisor and under whom many researchers have been working. She is actively involved in the preparation of textbooks for all standards from KG to PG. She has won two RELO USA e-teachers scholarship and completed a UG-sponsored minor research project. She is the chairperson English Language Committee Textbook Bureau, Bal Bharati, Maharashtra State. She is a member on the Board of Studies of RTMNU, BMCC Pune and Kavi Kulguru Kalidas Sanskrit University, Ramtek. She is the Vice President of Vidya Bharati Higher Education, New Delhi. She is the examiner for Business English Certificate course of Cambridge. It's really an honor to have such a vibrant personality with us today, and I'm sure everybody is excited to listen her. I would like to thank you, ma'am, for sparing time from your heavy schedule. And now on behalf of my college, I would like to request her kindly to enlighten us. Over to Dr. Sardeshpande ma'am.
Thank you, Dipali. A very good morning to all of you, Dynamic Director of Prerna College, Dr. Praveen Joshi sir, Principal Dr. Sanjaywar madam, all the staff members of Prerna College, and my dear students. Today, the topic given to me is effective non-verbal communication. Huh? What is this? When you talk about communication, you've been talking about communication since the last 7 days, and people might be telling you how to speak, how to go ahead with your ideas, how to express, isn't it? Yes, then communication is all about words, isn't it? When you want to communicate, you need words. Then what is this non-verbal communication? Verbal means using words. But now non-verbal communication, do you think that such a thing is possible? Give it a thought. And friends, in this session, we are going to have an interaction, okay? It is not going to be a one-way communication. We are going to you are also going to participate so that, you know, it becomes interesting. And I know that you are enjoying the session, isn't it? Okay, so then let us see what this non-verbal communication is. Non-verbal means, verbal means which require words. So non-verbal means which do not require words, isn't it? Then how is it possible? Yes, whenever you, even if you don't speak, whenever you enter a room, whenever you meet people, you are giving so many signals to that person. You, whenever you step out of the house, there are so many, when people look at you, you are emitting so many signals. People, just by looking at you, people can understand whether you are in a good mood, whether you are not in a good mood. And even we also, when we meet people, the first impression, it is said, isn't it, that first impression is the last impression. Yes, why is it said? Because the moment you see that person, sometimes you might, you don't know that person. Maybe that person is a stranger, but you feel, oh, this person seems to be very friendly, isn't it? And sometimes when you look at a person, you feel, oh my God, he's serious. I should not talk to him. Let me maintain my distance, isn't it? So this happens. You don't know anything about that person, but still you form your own opinions. So, you know, friends, we are communicating with our language. Yes, the body language speaks about you. It tells what kind of a person you are. Okay, so today when you are going to study how a non-verbal communication is effective, it is really very effective, you should also then consciously, even if we are conscious, even if we feel that we should not give negative, expression, but it's not in our hands. There are so many things happening automatically. So it is not in your hands, but the type of person you are, because you know the grooming which you've got, the circumstances you've dealt with. So all these things come out when on, and they are reflected on your face. If you're not well, automatically your eyes tell so many things about you. Maybe you are saying, I'm fine. But yes, the eyes tell that you are not fine. So, you know, the words, more than the words, your body, your tone, your pitch, your dressing, all these things speak a lot about you. It is said that only seven, you know, whenever you are, you know, you feel that communication is going on, only 7% is, research says that it is only 7% is through words, and 93% is through your gestures, through your body language, through your, like, through your apparel and all these things. So you have to be very careful. This is not a thing which can be ignored, you know. People don't teach all these things, but non-verbal communication is a very important thing, because in this world, when you will be going out and taking up various professions, so you should be careful as to how you are, whether you are approachable, and then how you present yourself in front of others. So even if you are doing a business, you should seem to be a very welcome person, happy person, approachable person. So, you know, all these things will happen only if you are very, very conscious and you make it a habit, so that, you know, you, whatever wrong habits you have, all those wrong habits will slowly go away. And because you have to make that conscious attempt, otherwise that will form, if that is a habit which has been formed, then it is very difficult for that habit to go away. So now, are you get up? Okay, now I will share my screen so that we can have a detailed, what you say, you'll get an experience of how non-verbal communications really happen. Okay, so now I'm going to share my screen. Just a moment. Thank you. Yes. Is it visible? Friends, is it visible?
Yes, ma'am.
Okay. And now I would request you to unmute the participants so that I'll have some discussion. So, friends, effective non-verbal communication. On the screen, you can see some gestures. And you people are so smart. I know this generation is a techno-savvy generation and Y generation. So I know that whenever you are talking with your friends on your mobiles, you send emojis, isn't it? And emojis also kind of communication. You communicate with the help of the emoji. There is a smiley, isn't it? There is a smiley which cries. Then there is a smiley which... which shows that I'm not saying anything. So these are the ways of communication. And nowadays, as it is, this is an age of SMS. This is an age of everything is condensing, everything is reducing, and people, we have 60 words news. So everything is reducing, and people are communicating more through signs, symbols. Okay. So now these are some of the gestures which you continuously make, and you are familiar with all these. That's why I have taken these. You are familiar with these. And we are going to talk about gestures also, but as the screen is open, I'll talk about this. Now look at the first screen. Are you familiar? If you have unmuted yourself, you can give me the answer. Yes. What is this V sign? Does it tell you? Anybody? Tell me.
It's for victory, ma'am.
Very good. Victory. But do you know how do you, V stands for victory? So if you show this sign to anybody, it is a victory. But you know, let me tell you that as far as gestures are concerned, in different countries, they connote different meanings. So you have to be very careful. You know, when you, if you go to UK, if you show this V, they will feel offended. Why? Because it has some history, you know. In the whenever there used to be the war, people, you know, during the ancient period, people used to fight with bows and arrows. Okay, but and if they wanted to defeat the enemy, and what they used to do is, if they caught hold of that enemy, they used to cut his two fingers. Why? So that he couldn't use his bow and arrow. Then, so that's why. If a person survives, he has to show these two fingers that, yes, I'm alive and still fighting. So that is victory. But the UK people don't like this symbol. So you have to be very careful when you talk with people from Britain. Okay. And so that's why. But, you know, these are some of them are universal gestures. And, you know, you can use them wherever you go. For example, if you say this, okay, if you say this, in any part of the world, people are bound to stop. Okay, if you do this, this is waving. Oh, you are not able to see me, I think. So this is victory. Then the next symbol, can you see my arrow? What is the next symbol? Can anybody tell me? This? What is this? Fast? This is nice, very nice. If somebody is looking nice, you do this, isn't it? So this is nice. The third symbol, this is, yes, it's one. I'm fond of you. I love you. This is the symbol. Then this one, see, thumbs up. Thumbs up will say that yes, fine, well done. Okay, but again, in some parts of the world, this is a derogatory thing and people will not use this gesture. Now look at this one, thumbs down. So this thumbs down, if nothing is going well, and if you did not like something, you can use this thumbs down. And this is a fist. This can be used for two, three things. A light tap on other's fist will say, hello, dude. Otherwise, it can show also a fist. That is, oh, I'm strong. I can give you a dish. Isn't it? Okay. Now we move ahead. Now, can you read this picture? Madam, I want people to unmute themselves so that we'll enjoy and they'll be able to give the answers. So look at the picture. look at this girl. Yes, people, children, please tell me what all things, without knowing this person, what all things can be told, what all things you can tell me about this person, tell me.
Excuse me, ma'am. As she is dressed in a wearing of Indian bride, and she seems to be happy as for her wedding.
Very good. So maybe she is going for a wedding, or maybe it is her own wedding. So basically, the costume, the dress tells you that it is something special which needs to be worn on the day of the wedding. Okay. And then again, there are some other symbols also which tell you that she is a bride and it's for wedding. Yes, what are the other symbols? Yes, what are the other symbols?
The authentic jewelry on her gives a symbol that it might be that it is her own wedding.
Yes, and again, some more things others also can tell me. Yes, jewelry speaks volumes then. What do the flowers tell you? What do the flowers tell you?
Flowers may indicate that she is a South Indian
girl. Good. Yes. So see, so many things we come to know. Flowers, generally, the South Indian people wear so many flowers. And therefore, she seems to be a South Indian. Then again, she is not smiling too loudly. She is smiling like her smiling is not a ha-ha smile. It is just a pleasant smile. So she, in India, a person she's a bride, so she cannot smile loudly. So this is a thing which shows coyness. That is, she's coy on the day of her wedding. That shows respect. Okay. So these are so many things. Again, if we talk on her, we can go on elaborating and we can find out so many other things from her facial expressions also. Okay. Now look at this lady. Can you see my arrow? What does this lady indicate? What do her expressions tell you? Yes, this lady.
She is frustrated by her work.
She's having problems. Yes.
Yeah.
Anything else?
She's having that paper balls thrown away. A cup of tea. It might be her fourth or fifth cup of tea as she is frustrated and stressed.
And that shows a lot of time. She has devoted a lot of time also here. Maybe something is not working. She is fed up with because something is not working for her. And the teacup and the tea tells you that it has been a long time she's working out on something, but the problem is not getting solved. And you can see these tissue papers. So, and there's one paper in her hand. Then look at her facial expressions. See this, look at her forehead. When you see these lines on the forehead, they tell you that you are in some tension, isn't it? There's something which is worrying you. These are the signs. Again, this hand gesture also. This hand gesture, when you keep your hand like this, it shows that you are in some tension. You are having some worries. Okay. Now, there are so many things we want to go fast because there are so many other things we need to do. Look at this boy, this gentleman. What can you say about this gentleman?
He is a model.
Huh?
What I think is he is a model giving a pose for a modelic shoot where he wants some natural touch for his background.
Okay, but if he is not a model, if he is, because nowadays many people sport a ponytail, isn't it? So, if a person is sporting a ponytail and look at his expressions, look at his eyes. Will you send it to bring cabbage? If like there are so many, like when we have children in our house, when we have such a grown-up youth in a house, we can ask him to bring vegetables. But will you be able to tell this boy? Do you think he will go and bring vegetables? So, is he so home? Does he look homely, or if he, do you feel that he has some attitude, or he has made a name? And what do you feel about this person? He and because of his ponytail, you feel that he is a person who wants to get noticed. If you call him a model, basically, what type of people go into modeling? People who are interested in themselves, people who want to show their they want people to notice them. That is the feature in them. They want people to notice them. They are flashy. So this is what is revealed by this gentleman. So there are so many things. But do you think he is approachable? Many people, if a person is too stylish, if a person is, so maybe people don't generally try to approach him, they keep a distance. So these are the things which go with how you carry yourself and with respect to your status also, there are so many things which are communicated through your body language. So it depends whether a person might be a wealthy person, but still the facial expression might show that he is approachable. Okay, so now we move on to the next one. Now look at these facial expressions. See, just looking at the eyebrows, even if you don't look at the whole face, first you can see the whole face, and looking at the whole face, you come to know what are the expressions. The first gentleman or first boy, he seems to be very happy. See, look at his lips, wide. He's showing his teeth, very happy from inside. And look at the eyebrows also. Then you look at the next person. Look at this girl, the second one in blue. How is she? Look at her eyebrows and look at her eyes and look at her lips. So the whole facial expression tells you that she is sad. Yes, she's very sad. See how she's closed her eyes. Look at the furrowed forehead. So you can see these, all these signs tell you that she is sad. Now the third symbol, this lady, this girl. Now look at her. Even if you don't know her, just by looking at her, you come to know that she is angry. Just look at her eyebrows. She's so angry. And look at her eyes also, dilated pupils. When your pupils are, you are angry, you just dilate your pupils. Now look at this fourth expression. Look at this boy. He has fear written on his face. He's afraid of something. And therefore, see the facial expressions, how they are. And just look at his eyebrows. Just look at all the four eyebrows. And just, even if somebody, nowadays you wear mask. So even if you wear a mask, still, your eyebrows, your eyes can reveal so many things about you. So just don't feel that if you are wearing a mask, your expressions won't be visible. There are so many things you communicate through your eyes, through your eyebrows. Okay? Okay, now we move to the next one. The eyes are said to be the windows of the soul. Just now I told you that even if you cover the face, just now looking at the face, naturally you will know the expressions. But if you just look at the eyes, too, see, now here only there are different kinds of eyes which are given to you. But now these eyes also tell you, speak about so many things. I will discuss this also. Now see, look at the first pair of eyes. Now these eyes, this person is looking sideways. Okay, so here when he is looking sideways, what does this mean? There are many things which you communicate through your eyes. For example, if the teacher asks you, who has done this mischief? And you know that it is the person next to you, what will you do? You will just rotate your eyes. You'll just turn your eyes towards that person to tell the teacher that he is the person. But that person will not know that you have given the information. So you have communicated with your eyes. Then see the next pair of eyes. These eyes are also looking sideways, but this person is looking stealthily. He is looking at the other person's activity, but maybe he doesn't want that the other person should know that he is looking at him. So these eyes are stealthy eyes. Yes, stealthily he is looking at the into other people's activities. Now, when eyes are closed, what do the closed eyes symbolize? The closed eyes symbolize, yes, peace. If a person is okay, I have accepted. Oh, if you want peace, it is just you close your eyes. But if you close, see this fourth pair of eyes on the right side, see how he has closed his eyes? This is plain closure of eyes. Just now we talked about plain closure of eyes. But this is, he's pressing the eyes hard. He has closed his eyes, but he is pressing the eyes hard. So when do we do this gesture? When do we press? You close eyes and you press them hard. Why? Because maybe, oh, it should not have happened. We say it should not have happened. And therefore, if you see a terrible accident, oh my God, so which you cannot see. And therefore, you close your eyes very, very hard. Okay, then here I have written some of the, there are eyes which you can see. Some eyes are sad. See, look at the eyes. Just above these closed eyes. Now look at these eyes. You see that there is sadness in this eyes, isn't it? So, and look at the eyes next to these eyes, this pair of eyes. They are very serious. There is something serious. He doesn't like this. So, a serious pair of eyes is also there. Then here below this, you have dilated pupils. Just now I told you when you are, maybe when you experience fear, so your eyes get dilated. Okay, or in surprise also, the eyes get dilated. But fear eyes, these are eyes which have seen fear, something fearful. And below that, you see again, this is, oh, how did this happen? So these kind of eyes, okay? So the eyes also speak a lot. They tell you. Now, if you are sad, if you are sick, you do not need to tell people that you are sick. It is reflected through your eyes. Now, see, here I have written some of the things. Eye gaze. So, eye gaze is very important. And again, in different countries, it connotes different meanings. So, eye gaze, when you are looking at a person, when, see, people say, look into my eyes. When you look into somebody's eyes, when you are truthful, you don't have anything to hide, you can meet the other people's eyes. So, that is, you say, eye gaze is very important. If you just avoid other person, meeting other person's eyes, that means you are not truthful. You don't want to, meet the other people's eyes, you know. So that is, so eye gaze. Gaze means looking at the person in front of you. So that is eye gaze. So gaze has 2-3 connotations. When you look at the stars also, you gaze the stars. And why? You like that. You like the stars. So you are looking at the stars. So that is also continuously looking is also gaze. So there are different, the word gaze has 2-3 meanings. And again, there are many types of eye gaze. It has so many varieties. Just now I told you, if you are, but in India, maybe you don't look into the eyes of the elders. They tell you that look into my eyes and speak, they tell the truth. Yes. But generally, out of respect, you will just lower your eyes. So that happens in the eastern part of the world. So eye gaze also connotes a lot of things. So when you are talking to a person, your eye gaze is very important. When you are in, maybe when you are appearing for your interview, or maybe when you are talking to an important person, you should look at him. If you don't look at him, if you look here and there, that shows that you are not interested. You should look at the person. That shows that you are interested. Blinking. If you continuously blink your eyes, if the teacher asks the student something, and if he blinks his eyes, that means he is anxious. He is, what you say, not comfortable. So that gives, that happens when you blink your eyes. So it shows that you are not comfortable. Dilated pupils, just now I told you, your pupils can be dilated. My God, for example, if you have not expected people at home and suddenly there are your friends who have been waiting there to give you a surprise party, and then, oh my God, you people are here, and your eyes will be dilated. So the same will happen when you are experiencing some fearful situation. Then I told you about plain closed eyes. Plain closed eyes, very comfortable when you are at peace, meditating, silent. So this is plain closed eyes. Then pressed closed eyes. Pressed closed eyes, I told you that you cannot see that particular thing happening. Oh my God, how has this happened? Thing happened. So you will close your eyes, you will press them hard and squint. So, oh, is this so? Oh, I did not expect this. Oh, acha. So this is so. So that is squint. Okay. Now we'll move ahead. Now see, just now we talked about the full facial expression. Then we talked about how you communicate through your eyes. Now let us see how you communicate through your mouth. See, here we have different kinds of mouths. And the first mouth is silent. So this is a self-composed person. The first picture is very, very composed. The second is smile, full brooded smile. So this person is very happy, or maybe he's faking happiness. Just look at him. And then the third person, angry. So when you're angry and this person is shouting, so he has opened his mouth. And look at his eyes and the furrowed temple. It shows that he is angry. Now look at this fourth person. He has turned his mouth. Just see. Yes, on one side. So this shows that, oh, he doesn't like it. So this expression is, oh, okay, you must have done so. So this is, he hates this person. So if you hate a person, if you don't like something, this is the expression. Then you move on to the next expression. Oh, impressed. Okay, I'm impressed. So then look at this. Oh, yuck. He has his tongue out. So this, oh, yuck, oh my God, if he's embarrassed also, two expressions in two situations, you'll put your tongue out. Now look at this, these three figures at the bottom. Here this is surprise, okay? Then see the middle one, obnoxious. Oh, I don't like this. I don't like it. I don't like this. Poor, oh my God, again this, again tomorrow. So you don't like it. And this one is, he's jealous of the person. Oh, you must have done so. So this is you are jealous or you don't care about the person. So these are the expressions which you communicate and your mouth communicates. Okay. So there are so many things we've talked about. Now we move ahead. See, these are universal symbols. You go to any country and only the thumbs up sign, I told you. Maybe in some countries it is derogatory, but otherwise it is okay. Well done. Then this boy in the middle, he is saying stop. He is just showing his fingers, full palm. And that is anywhere you go, if somebody is doing this, you will have to stop. Now look at this. This person is yawning. That shows that he is bored. Anytime, whenever a person yawns, he keeps his hand on his mouth, or again, he must have put his fingers on his mouth that, oh, I don't want to speak about it. So that is again, he doesn't want to speak. When you don't want to speak anything, you keep shut. And therefore, this is the gesture that I don't want to speak. Now here, this boy, small boy, he has closed his eyes with his, again, hand gesture. So with your hands, you close your eyes. That shows that you don't want to see this thing. Then look at this lady in the middle. Yes, what is she doing? This is the symbol which you nowadays frequently use. So this is a sign of a phone. So if you don't speak, but if you just show this gesture, you're saying, okay, call me or have a talk, I'll call you. So this is signaling, talking on phone. That yes, we'll talk on phone. Now this gentleman, old gentleman, he has put his index finger, the first finger on his lips. So anywhere you go, if you do this, people will understand that you need to keep quiet. So these are universal symbols which are followed everywhere. Okay. Now these also we'll do fast. See, this is again the Lord Buddha, and he also has lifted his palm. And now this symbol is not the symbol of stop. Okay. Look at the fingers. The fingers are a little bit bent. Okay. So this is blessings. This gesture shows blessings. So he is blessing. Okay. Then look at the next one. This is there are three people here, and this is the guru and this is the shishya maybe. He is touching the feet, or maybe he is seeking apology. If you have done a mistake, if this is the son and these are parents, maybe he is touching the feet. So whenever you touch the feet, that is the expression that you are seeking apology. Or maybe now this person, this father is blessing this child, this son. So the third, again, now we move on to the third symbol. Now this gentleman is waving. When you beckon somebody, when you are beckoning somebody with your fingers, that says that come here, come. That is the sign for come. So anyway you go in the world, and if you show this gesture, it will denote that that person is asking you to come. Then look at this Aishwarya Rai. She has folded her hands, palms together. She kept her palms together. So that in India, it means namaskar, yes. So in US, people greet with shake hands. But here in India, we do this. So in Eastern countries, it is namaskar. Okay. That shows respect. Now to the bottom, here this father is patting his son. So, you know, if you just pat also, it communicates love. It communicates so many things. Just a small tap. You don't need to speak anything. Just a tap on your head will say that, yes, I am there for you. Okay, that it gives you solace. Whenever the doctor touches you, you feel comfortable. So, all these are the mother pats. Or when you do something good and your teacher pats on your back, so that also is a very comforting and motivating sign. Then here, this lady in the green dress, look at her. And now see, look at both these girls. The green, this girl in green, she has also crossed her arms. And this girl in white also has folded her arms. Okay, she has folded her arms. Both of them have folded her arms. But look at the person in green. If you happen to be there, you will not go to this green girl wearing the green, but you will go to this girl who is in shorts, white t-shirt. Why? Because look at her face. She's happy. So, but you know, the folded hands, they show that, yes, I'm not open to, like, you can talk to me, but I will decide what I have to do. That is what is being communicated when you fold your hands, that you are not in a mood to listen. Not in a mood to listen means, okay, you can tell me whatever you want, but okay, I will decide what I have to do. So the girl in green, she's not, you will never approach her because look at her face, she is not in a receptive mood. But this one in the white, she's happy. Yes, you can talk to me. Yes, but I'll decide whether I agree or I don't agree. So if you are talking to a person, if you are there in an interview, don't sit with folded hands because they show that you are reserved. You are not open to suggestions and advice. So folded hands are something negative. You have to keep your hands at the side so that it shows that you are open to advice and suggestions. Okay, now let us move to the next one. See now leg gestures. We've seen hand gestures. Now look, we will see the leg gestures. Now, this person who is standing straight. Yes, whenever a teacher is talking to a student, he stands straight. That is, his legs are parallel and they are like he's erect. So this is, but he can here, it is being attentive. So this posture tells you that you are very, very attentive. Now look at the next one. Here the legs are apart, but they are firmly placed on the ground. So if somebody pushes you, you will not fall. Why? Because your legs are firmly on the ground and you are open. Yes, you are ready to listen. Again, look at this third girl. She has crossed her legs. So again, crossed her legs and she has folded her arms too. So that itself shows reserve. She is reserved. She will not be very open with you. So these are the gestures when you, even you do this, it's not that maybe every day you are a, what you say, social person, but there is a mood. And if you don't want to talk to people, automatically your hands are folded and you sit in this position or you stand like this. So this is, this posture tells you that she is a reserve. She is not in a mood to have a talk with you. She wants to keep to herself. That's why legs crossed. Folded arms. Now look at this. Look at this. Now here her feet, she's sitting again with her hands folded and even legs, one leg, one knee on the other. So these are all okay. I'm ready to listen, but not in a mood to be receptive. Okay. If I don't like the suggestion, I will talk directly with you. That is, I'll not accept the suggestions. Now look at this boy, this gentleman. Below here, sitting on the sofa. Yes, He has also folded his leg. He has kept one knee over the other. But this shows confidence. This shows comfortable position. And he is in a good mood. So this is how you should sit. And if you are at home, if you want to be comfortable, you can just place your legs in the, what you say, parallel. But if you are keeping one knee over, this is how when you go to somebody's place, when you go to for a professional work, you should be sitting like this. Now, this is also one knee over the other, but this is called four, a sign of four. And here, this shows that, yes, I am ready to talk to you. Come what may. Okay, come on, talk to me. What do you want? I have all the solutions. So look at this gentleman. Ready. He's ready with all the solutions. Yes, come on, talk to me. I'll tell you what it needs to be done. So this is that posture. Okay. Now look at this girl. She has raised one of her legs. And again, this is also in cross. So that means she's shy. She is not going to speak at once. So she is shy. Now look at this last picture. Here these two, this lady and this gentleman, this boy is standing here. This boy has his legs apart. That is, yes, he's open. Now this lady has put one foot in the front. So that shows that, yes, she's going to go ahead with the conversation. She doesn't mind going ahead in the relationship, or maybe. So this is that gesture. Okay. Now, just now we've seen so many gestures. We've seen we've seen facial expressions. We've seen the leg gestures. We've seen the hand gestures. So all these gestures, they come under kinesics. Okay, these come under kinesics. Now, people who are attempting their net set, they have this paper on nonverbal communication. So it is very useful for them. They should know these words also. But the other students can just enjoy. Don't worry about the words. So in gestures, we have the adapters, we have the emblems, and we have the illustrators. Now, what do you mean by adapters? Adapter means if you are feeling, if you are feeling bored, if you don't know what to do, what do? You, if there is a pen lying on the table, you'll just click the pen. Out, in, out, in. So that shows your anxiety. You will shake your legs. So all these symbols are showing anxiety. Scratching, you scratch your leg, then you scratch your hand, scratch your head. Twirling hair, if it is a girl, then, or if it's even if it's a boy, if you just go on twirling your hair, then that shows you are angry. If you're fidgeting, doing this, that shows that there is some problem with you, you're not comfortable, you want to go out or something like that. Fidgeting with the fingers. Then if you don't have anything to do, if you're very, very anxious, what you'll do is fix a crooked tie. And even if the tie is properly in its place, you just hold it, do it, correct it once again. So these are the things which you do when you are nervous, okay? Or when you are getting bored. So then these are called adapters. You use objects or you do some activities with your own self. Now the emblems. Emblems are also gestures. Now these are the gestures. How we saw the gestures on the first slide, victory symbol, then the thumb symbol, or even if you do something like this, even if you circle index finger around the head of, so we say, oh, she's gone mad. If you want to say she's crazy, so what do? We just make circle with our index finger. Yes, you hold your index finger towards your temple and you move it round. So that is saying that he or she is crazy. Illustrators means you will use your hands. Now, for example, if you want to say, oh my God, it was a big party. So to symbolize big, you'll just open your hands. If you want to be small, just a little bit. So that little bit also you will show with your hand. So all the things which you, maybe to show the size, if you use your hand, then they are called illustrators. Now, head movements and postures. So see, with your head, you can communicate so many things. If you want to say yes, not necessarily you use words, you will just say yes. If you move your head side to side, left to right, you are saying no. If you are doing up and down movement of your head, that is yes, isn't it? And if you just tilt your head a little bit, That means you are interested, you are looking with interest, listening with interest. So that these are the expressions, these are the gestures. Now posture. Look at the posture. How is this girl in the picture? She is standing with her hands on the hips. So that itself shows it is not a good sign. It is a sign of attempted dominance, you know. You are showing your dominance. Yes, if somebody wants to fight, he will just keep his hands on his shoulder, or hands on his hips, not on the shoulder. Shoulder is a friendly sign. Okay, now you are putting your elbows out. See, in this gesture, you are keeping your elbows out. So that is, you are ready with defense. The elbows you can use for defense. Yes, come, if you want to fight, I'm ready. So that is the expression this lady is doing, and this is the posture. Okay, then look at this. If you are leaning on a chair, if you're just sitting, but you are just leaning, you've pushed a little bit down, you're just lying on that chair, that shows maybe informality. That is how you sit in your house when you're watching a television. You do not sit upright. You just push yourself down and lean a little bit. So that is comfortable. Or maybe when you are indifferent, everybody is sitting upright and you are just slouching, you are just leaning back. So that shows that you are not interested in the conversation. Now, straddling a chair is a sign of dominance. See, this girl, how is she sitting on the chair? Just look at this. So this is a sign of dominance. Look at her attitude. Look at the way she's sitting. So it shows dominance. Then, if you lean forward, when somebody is speaking, if you lean forward, that shows that you are interested. So these are the head movements and postures. Now, eye contact. I already talked to you about eye contact. You know, with eyes, you can communicate so many things. Yes. If there are guests in your house, and if you want that the child should not, whatever he is saying, he should not say, you just dilate your eyes. That is, you will intimidate that person, your child, with your eyes. So with your eyes, you can control your child. Even if you look strictly to your students, they know that, yes, no mischief. The teacher does not want any mischief. So that is also a signal which you can give with your eyes. Again, initially we talked about so many signals that you can communicate with your eyes. If somebody is talking and if the person who's talking asks you, yes, do you agree? And if you just close your eyes, that shows yes. So you just blink, close your eyes and give that indication that yes, I am to follow whatever you say. So these are the way you communicate with your eyes. Then facial expressions. So already facial expressions, we've talked about it. When you are excited, when you are angry, when you are confused, the expressions are written on your face. When you are frustrated, when you are sad, I showed you all the expressions. How you look when you are frustrated, how you look when you are sad. Okay. Then smile. When you smile, your eyebrows are raised, isn't it? Yes. And so you also know whether it is somebody is giving you a light-hearted smile or it is what kind of a smile it is. If a person is getting well from his sickness, and you know that person is also happy, but the way he will smile is different. Then again, if you are seeing there's something serious, there are lines on your forehead and there is your brow is furrowed. So you will have your lips tightly closed. So these are the facial expressions you will give with your. So these are the facial expressions. So now we've talked about eye contact. We've talked about facial expressions. And now we are going to talk about proxemics. What is proxemics? See, students, many times you don't realize this, that people need space. You know, you have to maintain space. If you go and talk, if you go too close to a person and try to talk to that person, maybe that person will not like. So there is we should maintain space while communicating. So research has shown, and how much space should you maintain? So it depends on the relationship you have with the person. For example, if it is a very intimate relationship, if you are talking to your child, if you are talking to your husband, so that is a very intimate relationship. So that person can come any close. So that it's not necessary that the person should stand at a distance only. So that person has the liberty to come close to you. So intimate people, people who are very close, they can come very close to you. That is, maintain a distance of 0 inches to 1.5 feet. So this is the distance you should, this is given for the intimate relationships. But if there is a personal space, what does personal space mean? Okay, you are my close friend. Yes, but friends also, though they are our special people in our lives, maybe neighbors also, maybe relatives also, but they are not as close as maybe the husband and wife or the mother and child. So this is the distance, this distance they should maintain, 1.5 feet to 4 feet. So this is the distance they should maintain. Then social space. Right now we are talking about social space. In Corona, we are talking about maintaining social distance. So this is the social space. When we talk to strangers, when we are talking to people outside, we should maintain this distance. So this is 4 feet to 12 feet distance. And when you are giving a lecture, when you are talking to general public, so this is a great distance which you keep. So this is public. So a great distance, maybe 12 feet or more. So this is, we are talking about space, because, you know, people don't like if you encroach their space, you know. For example, in the bus also, nobody will like to go in a bus which is crowded. Again, trains also. And what you do is go there and reserve your place. Everybody wants to keep his or her own space. So you need space. Okay, so space is very important. Now, haptics. Haptics means communication by touch. So there are so many, you know, touch is also very important. Touch communicates so many things. If a person is not feeling well, and if you just touch his forehead, he will feel comfortable, isn't it? So touch also comes. You don't need to speak anything. You just go, even if you stand there. But here right now we are talking about touch. So motherly touch, that is very important. Now see, there are 5 types of touches we have discussed here. First, the functional, professional level touch. So here, there are some people who have the right to touch us. Not everybody. We don't like some stranger touching us, isn't it? But these are the people, like, for example, due to their professions, they can touch us. For example, barbers, hairstylists, doctors, nurses, tattoo artists, if somebody is drawing a mehndi. So these people have security screeners. Yes, these people can touch you. So these are the functional touches. And you don't mind also, because you are mentally prepared that these people are going to touch you. Then social polite level touch. So that is a handshake, a pat on the arm or the shoulder. So these are social people, teachers, relatives, they can have this touch. Okay, so you can have this touch from these people. Then friendship warmth level touch. So again, if you are in a romantic relationship, a person can give you a hug. So this is a friendship, or maybe this is a touch which you can experience with your friends. Then love intimacy, or best friends or close family members, romantic partners, they can touch your face, they can hold your hands, they can embrace you. So this is the touch which these members are allowed. And last touch is, it is also used in many other contexts. For example, during play, if you're playing something, if you are in a wrestling match, you need to touch the other person. So if you're in a physical conflict, if you're fighting with somebody, so you will touch. So these are the reasons for which you touch people. And you communicate so many things. Okay. Now, vocalics. Now, vocalics, this is very important. You know, maybe you speak, you utter some words, but the way you say something, it communicates so many things. Okay. If I say, oh, so smart. Oh, so smart. You're so smart. So this is my tone tells you that, yes, I'm saying smart, but I'm not indicating that you are really smart. So these are the things which are communicated through the vocalics. Now, vocalics is the study of paralanguage, which includes the vocal qualities that go along with verbal messages. So, you know, your pitch, your volume. Pitch means what? For example, pitch, volume, vocal quality, and verbal fillers. These are the things which go in vocalics. Now, see, if there is a conversation going on, then if you're very happy, what you will do is you will raise your pitch. Okay. So, for example, oh, hi, everybody. So, that is greeting. So, you will, the pitch goes high. And now, when I'm going to end my conversation, when I'm going to end my speech, my pitch goes down. So, it is a falling emphasis. There is, that is called falling emphasis. So, you know that the speech is going to come to an end. So, that is fall. So, this is about pitch. Then, volume. Yes, if somebody is talking, I'm teaching and somebody is talking at the back, I will just increase the volume and then I will control people with the volume. So that is, I'm being more intense. So, you know, even in typing, whenever you are typing, whenever you are sending emails, if you type in all caps, that you should not be doing this because it says that you are shouting at that person. It is not, but if you use a good font, if you use a shorter font, smaller font, that indicates that the person is not, if the person is, what you say, soft and gentle. So that is how you, those are the etiquettes of writing and drafting emails also. Now, speech rate, the speaking rate. A slow speaker, if you are talking to a person and if he's slow in giving the answers, tells you that he is not interested, he is bored, that person himself is boring others. Okay, so that is, a slow speaker is boring. And then slow means very slow. Okay, then a fast speaker, if a person is too fast, then again you don't understand what the person is speaking. Hence, you should not be very slow and you should not be very fast. So this, now these are some of the things. Accent communicates many things. For example, now you look at this. There is one sentence given here. She is my friend. So I will say the sentence in three different accents. If I say, she is my friend. Now here I'm stressing on she. She is my friend. See, Lata, not Geeta, but she. Yes, she is my friend. I'm stressing on she. She is my friend. The next one is, she's my friend. Okay, she's not your friend. She's my friend. So I'm stressing on my friend. So she is my friend and she's my friend. And the third one is, she's my friend. Okay. Yes, she's just my friend. So you are emphasizing on that friend. She's not, what you say, neighbor. She's not a relative. She's a friend. So you are emphasizing, stressing on that word, friend. Now we move on. So see, the accent, the sentence is the same, but the accent tells you, it communicates three different things. Then substituting. So many a times you don't need to talk. If somebody is explaining something and if you just say, huh. So that is, yes, you are not saying anything, but just the huh, that communicates. Okay. That tells the person that, yes, I am listening. Then regulating, that is, again, this we've already talked about, falling pitch and like when you are greeting somebody, the pitch goes high. When you're ending the conversation, ending the speech, it is, the pitch goes down. Contradicting means you say something, but your expressions, your voice is saying something and your expressions are saying something else. Huh, I'm fine. Okay. How are you saying that? If you say just, I'm fine. I'm fine. So that is, you are saying and meaning also that you are fine. But you say, okay, I'm fine. So that doesn't mean that you are fine. You are saying, the words are saying, you are saying these words that you are fine, but you don't mean. So this is contradicting. We've talked about proximity. And then territoriality. So now we are coming to the end. Now what is territoriality? Territoriality, that means territory. So you are talking about space. Just now I have talked to you about space, but territory also. This is my territory. You tell others that this is my territory. If it is your house, you have a fence. So that tells you that this is my area. So you build a wall around your house to tell that this is my area. So you speak with the things you build or the things you keep in the house. You communicate so many things. So this is your territory. Okay. Now, this is about your house or something which belongs to you. Okay. You will keep it with you, showing that you are the owner of that. But many a times when you go in class, you will sit on a particular bench. Nobody has given allotted you those that bench, but you'll go and sit on the bench, okay, desk and bench. And maybe on the every day you it happens, you go and sit on that typical bench only. So maybe on the next day, if somebody else sits there, you don't like it. Okay, it's not reserved for you, but still every day you sit there. So you have marked your territory. You are telling that, oh, with your eyes, you're telling him, this is my place. Okay. Then temporarily reserve. For example, you know, they want to catch a bus and there is so much of rush. What you do is you put your handkerchief on the seat to tell people, okay, I have reserved the seat. The bus doesn't belong to you, but you will do this to mark your territory, to say, mark your space, that this belongs to me. In the restaurant, if you are sitting, and if you want to use the washroom, if you then you are afraid that, okay, if I move away right now from here, if I get up, then this table will be gone. So I want to reserve this table. So what you will do is keep some of your belongings there, or maybe belonging is something, maybe if somebody steals it, then you will be at a loss. So maybe people, what do? They keep their coffee there, cold drinks there. That is half. They'll just keep the half empty cup of coffee there to say that this is reserved. Okay. But you cannot put a laptop over there and go here and there. Somebody might take it. Okay. Or if you keep something which is, means for example, like a pencil, if you keep something like a pencil there, so that you cannot use the pencil as reservation of space. Why? Because the people can just come and throw the pencil here and there, or shift the pencil from one place to maybe the other table or something. So this is also, but these are the ways you mark your territory or show people, communicate with the people that this is my place. Now, chronemics. This is how time affects communication. You know, time is also very important. For example, early in the morning, if you ring someone up, maybe that person is not in the mood to talk to you. That is because of the time, morning time. Ring him. He's just awake and you troubling him. So that time of the day is also important. Then the season, it is raining, people are frustrated, cannot move out. So at that time, if you want to talk something important, maybe not, they will not reply. So that is because they are frustrated. So that is because of the season. Now here I've talked about time of the day also. So, you know, if a person is not well, so that is the time that he's going through a bad phase, and that's why he has responded to you in this way. So that communication will be different. Then, for example, if there are, again, if you visit a doctor or a politician or somebody, they'll make you wait outside. So that is, see, for some people, you don't mind waiting for some people, but not for everyone. If somebody keeps you, if somebody has invited you for dinner and he keeps you waiting, then what will happen? You will not like it. So time is very important. That shows if somebody maintains his time, that gives a positive impression. Then again, see, timing of the time, how you deliver your dialogue. For example, if I'm saying something and you don't let me speak, you interrupt in between. So that means you are not allowing me to speak. So again, that is a bad gesture. So you should wait, have patience. Then many a times when I'm speaking something and I expect you to answer, okay, have you done this or something like that? And you keep mum. Many a time I want that you should take my side, but that at that time you are keeping silent. So silence also speaks volumes. Okay, so speaking at the correct time is also communicating the right thing. Okay, and laughing at the wrong time. You should know when to laugh. So if you laugh at the wrong time, that is a wrong communication. It communicates that that person doesn't care for whatever you are saying, or that person is teasing you, so he's laughing. So again, you have to maintain that the time is very important. Now, personal presentation. So this also I've discussed, that your jewelry, if you're wearing a jewelry, it speaks about you, it talks about. If there's a branded thing, if you're wearing a branded watch, it tells you about the status of that person. Okay. Then hairstyle, just now I told you, we saw in some pictures how hairstyle speak about you. If it is a girl with a plait, oiled hair and a plait, you will see that she's a traditional lady. Okay. If it is a girl with her with what you say, hairstyle in steps or something like that, then you might find her very fashionable. Okay, so these are the, what you say, personal presentation. We are talking about personal presentation. Maybe you pierce some of your body parts. If a girl pierces the nose, maybe it won't be, it is expected in the society. But if a boy pierces his chin or something, then it goes, it communicates something different. And men with long hair, men with short hair. So again, it is according to the, maybe in the ancient days, people used to have long hair. But now you have to keep your hair cut. So that shows that you are concerned about your hygiene. You are taking care of your hair. It is well groomed. Even if you are sporting a beard, it should be trimmed properly. It should be in shape. Otherwise, if the beard is growing anyhow, then you look disheveled and you don't look. You are not in a presentable condition. Okay. So your clothes also. Not necessarily that if your clothes, if you have just two clothes, but if you have washed them, ironed them, then if they are clean clothes, then again you communicate something different. Yes. And if you are wearing what you say, very expensive clothes, but they are not ironed, so that itself shows that you don't keep your things properly. So there are so many things which, like for example, even the symbols. If a person is wearing cross, automatically you know that he's a Christian. So these are some of the things which are personal and which your personal belongings or your personal, the things which you wear, they communicate so many things. Now the last, we come to the environment. Now environment, if you go to a house and if it is in a mess, that tells you something about your condition also. If I'm not in a, what you say, mood today, my house will be in a mess. If I am organized in my mind, my house will also be organized. If you go to a table, if you go to a, an office, and if you see that the employee's table is in a mess, that means either that person has a lot of work, he doesn't have time to, but still, people who have a lot of work also, they will keep their things in proper place. So the environment speaks a lot about you, what type of a person you are. Okay, and the books which are there in the house, the books which, so all those things speak about you. How, so many gestures, so many, the space, the time, the environment, all these things are very, very important. Okay, so with this, I can come to the end of the session. I hope you must have enjoyed. And if you have any questions to ask, you can. Yes? Yes, Deepali, if anybody wants to ask, otherwise we'll stop here.
Anybody wants to ask?
Did you enjoy, students? Did you enjoy?
Anybody? Okay, everybody saying as much in the chat box. Which is
there. Okay.
Yeah. Ma'am, what a wonderful session it was. Thank you so much, ma'am, for such enriching and very informative session. I'm sure that your talk will immensely benefit each one of us. You told us about how we can communicate non-verbally with our eyes, facial expression, hand and legs, gestures. You also told us about different type of universal gestures, haptics, vocalics, and about personal presentations and involvement. It was really a memorizing session. Thank you so much for your valuable time. Now it's time to present vote of thanks. I profoundly thank you to Professor R.C. Bilhani sir, President of Prerna Seva Mandal, Dr. S.C. Gulhani sir, Secretary of Prerna Seva Mandal, Abhilasha Gurdev ma'am, CEO of Prerna Seva Mandal, Dr. Praveen Joshi sir, director of Prerna Seva Mandir, Dr. Ujjwal Lanjewar sir, principal of Prerna College of Commerce, all HODs of all departments, all faculty members and all technical staff and all my dear students. Once again, thank you so much. Have a nice day.
Thank you.
Manjushri madam, well done.
Thank you, Joshi sir. Did you like this session?
For our institution that you have joined us today.
Wow, thank you.
We feel really privileged.
It was my pleasure, sir.
So nice of you. Thank you. Yeah. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
And have a good day.
Yes.
It was a marvelous presentation. Wonderful.
Did you really listen?
Yeah. I was always there.
Okay.
So I was a bit busy with official work.
Okay.
I was listening to you.
Okay. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Finished?
Mm-hmm. Yes, sir.
Yes.
Have a good day. Bye-bye.
Yes. Okay.
Yes, ma'am. Hello.